Morning, Vanachar. Today we'll be discussing about mechanism of combination. I'm Dr. Swatika, Assistant Professor, Department of Biochemistry. So, before moving on to mechanism, we'll see what are hormones. So, hormones are basically chemical substances which are synthesized by one type of cells and transported to the blood to act on another type of cells. So, we have different chemical substances being synthesized in our body. And the mechanism of their action or the way they act can be divided into three main categories. One is endocrine, the second one is paracrine, third one is autocrine. Endocrine means the substances are synthesized from one type of cells, and the substance which are synthesized, there is nothing but the hormones, are secreted into the blood and they reach their desired target cell, which is at a distance from the source of secretion. Example for this includes and other hormones. Paracrine is nothing but the substance or hormones which is synthesized by one type of cells and will act on the consequent cell or which is present nearer to that. So nearby cell or the next one cell. So examples for this includes GIT hormones. Autocrine is nothing but the cell synthesizes a substance which will act on its own, bring about the desired effects. Example for this includes prostaglandins. Here we can see the diagram of what I have discussed before. First diagram is the endocrine, where the gland cell, which is a type of cell, will secrete the hormone, and this hormone will enter into the bloodstream. And through the bloodstream, once it reaches the desired target cell, the target cell has got receptors for the specific receptors for the hormones. So the hormones can go and bind to the substance present in the target cell and can bring about the desired effect. This is what is meant by endocrine. Paracrine is nothing but a particular type of cell will secrete the hormone, and this hormone will act on the hormone specific receptors which are present nearby in the nearby cells. Here you can see the cells are present anatomically nearer to the cell which is secreting the hormone. This is nothing but paracrine. Autocrine is the gland and the target cell are the same. This, the cell will secrete its own hormones, which will come and again rebind to the receptor present on its cell membrane and bring about the desired effects. What are the functions of hormones? So we have varied functions of hormones, and we have categorized these functions into three major categories. First is the growth and development. So what are the hormones which bring about growth and development? Are ACTH, which is nothing but adrenocorticotropic hormone, TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone, FSH, follicle stimulating hormone, and LH, luteinizing hormone. Second major function is by bringing about homeostatic control of metabolic pathway. So what are the hormones which bring about this function is parathormone with calcium, antidiuretic hormone, which bring about the water and electrolyte balance. So we have the first one, parathormone, which brings about the calcium homeostasis, and antidiuretic hormone, which brings about the water and electrolyte homeostasis. Third category or third major function is regulation of energy production. So for energy storage or the to store the substrates which will provide with the energy, two hormones play a major role. One is insulin, the other one is glucagon. Again, hormones can be classified into two groups. So we have classified into two groups, group one and two, and it has got its own specific properties. So we'll discuss each of the properties. So group one has got lipophilic solubility, that is, it is lipid soluble, and group two is water soluble. Group one, since it is lipid soluble, it needs transport proteins to get transported to the target cell, whereas group two doesn't need any transport protein. And group one, which is lipid soluble hormones or whatever, has got a longer plasma half-life, whereas the group 2, which is water soluble, has got shorter plasma half-life. And the receptors for group 1 lipid soluble hormones are intracellularly located, whereas the group 2 hormones has got receptors located on the plasma membrane. So what are the mediators which bring about the action is hormone receptor complex in case of group 1, and we have an array of mediators, which include cyclic AMP, cyclic GMP, calcium, inositol, triphosphate, diacylglycerol, and protein kinase inhibitors. So what are the examples for group 1 receptor hormones? Includes steroids, thyroid hormones, calcitriol, and retinoids. Whereas group 2 includes polypeptide hormones, proteins, glycoproteins, and catecholamines. Classification of hormones by chemical nature. So how do we classify hormones? By either classifying what is their chemical nature. So again, here we have so many categories, among which we have classified into three major categories. First one is the polypeptide or protein hormones. That is, the hormone structurally is made up of polypeptides. And it includes adrenocorticotropic hormone, insulin, parathormone, and these are basically water-soluble hormones, and they circulate freely, and they have got a short half-life of 10 to 30 minutes. Since they are water-soluble, as we have previously discussed, they bind to cell membrane receptors. Second category is steroid hormones. Steroid hormones examples are cortisol and sex hormones, and they are hydrophobic, that is, they are lipid-soluble, and they circulate only with the only after binding with transport protein, and their half-life is 30 to 90 minutes, and they bind with the intracellular receptor to bring about the desired effect. Third category is amino acid related hormones, which includes thyroid hormones and catecholamines. Again, these are water soluble. The fourth one, a minor category, is fatty acid hormones, which includes prostaglandins. Here we have classified hormones by mechanism of action. Mechanism of action is basically depend upon the type of receptor or the location of the receptor. Hence, the location of receptors on the cell surface will bring about the action of peptide hormones and catecholamines, whereas intracellular receptors bind to steroid hormones and thyroid hormones. So hormone receptors. So what are hormone receptors? Hormones will mediate the biological effect by binding to its specific receptors. So most of the hormone receptors are proteins. They have the functional domains of hormone receptor has got two things. One is the recognition domain to which the hormone will bind. The second one is the signal transduction domain, which is coupled to the intracellular downstream functions. So here you can see a picture of a hypothetical cell, and this is the plasma membrane or a lipid bilayer membrane. And here we have got different shapes of receptors for many peptide hormones, growth hormones, and amino acid related hormones. And here you have got the nucleus in which the other steroid hormones and other related receptors are present, bound to the DNA. So what happens, these type of steroid hormones will traverse, which are lipid soluble, will traverse the cell membrane and will come to the nucleus and bind to the receptors which are bound to the DNA and bring about their action. And those hormones which will be bound to the such type of receptors includes steroid hormones and thyroid hormones. And we have got another type of receptor which is also present intracellularly but is not present intranuclearly, which is the cytoplasmic receptors, to which specific steroid hormones will come and bind, like glucocorticoids. So, cell surface receptor. So, the structure of cell surface receptor has got three domains. One is the extracellular domain. Second one is the transmembrane domain. Third one is the cytoplasmic or intracellular domains. So, the extracellular domain is nothing but the ligand binding domain, to which the hormone will come and bind. The transmembrane domain, which will transverse the membrane or spans the membrane, and the receptor also has got the cytoplasmic or intracellular domain, which will bring about the signal transduction and desired intracellular effects. What are the hormones which binds to the cell surface receptors? The hormones which bind to the cell surface receptor are categorized based on the which type of second messenger it is passing on the signal to bring about the downstream effects. So if the second messenger is going to be cyclic AMP, the catecholamines are the hormones which will bring about the effects through cyclic AMP. And nitric oxide and atrial natriuretic peptide has got the second messenger as cyclic GMP. And calcium or phosphatidyl inositol or both will act as the second messenger for thyrotropin releasing hormone and gonadotropin releasing hormone. And protein kinase is the second messenger for insulin. Hormones bind to intracellular receptors. So what are the two types of receptors which are present intracellularly? Cytosolic receptors and nuclear receptors. So cytosolic receptor examples are androgen and estrogen, which are the hormones which act through cytosolic receptors. And the thyroid hormones, that is T3 and T4, triiodothyronin and tetraiodothyronin will act through nuclear receptors. Steroid hormone receptors. Steroid hormone receptors has got functional domains, which includes the carboxy terminal binding with the hormone and an adjacent DNA binding region. In the DNA binding region, one region will activate the gene transcription, and there are also regions for the translocation of receptors from the cytoplasmic to nucleus, and there is also one region which binds to the heat shock protein in the absence of liver. That is, what it means is that as a whole, it has got a carboxy terminal binding where the hormone will come and bind. And there is an adjacent region where the DNA can bind. That is, once the hormone comes and binds to the receptors, the hormone receptor complex will translocate itself into the nucleus and will bind to the DNA by way of DNA binding region. So in that one region will activate gene transcription. And we have got another region in the DNA binding region where the heat shock protein can come and bind if there is no ligand, that is, if there is no hormone binding to the receptor. Insulin receptors. Insulin receptors are basically heterotetradimers, that is, it is made up of two different subunits, and the two different subunits are existing as dimers. So it is basically heterotetradimers, alpha 2 and beta 2. This dimer is linked by multiple disulfide bonds. And the extracellular membrane subunit is nothing but the alpha subunit, which can bind with the insulin hormone. And the membrane spanning subunit is the beta subunit, through which the tyrosine residue will transduce the signal into the internal of the interior of the cell. Other polypeptide hormone receptors are characterized by the presence of seven domains which are spanning the plasma membrane, and they transduce the signals by altering the rate of production of cyclic AMP. So again, group 1 hormones. So group 1 hormones, what are the mechanism of action through which they act? We are categorizing into two many different types. So either they act through the intracellular receptor gene expression, or they can be a lipophilic hormone. That is, they can traverse the cell membrane and bind to cytoplasm or nuclear receptors. That's what they mean. And the diffusion is by passive. That is, by passive diffusion. And they bind with cytoplasmic receptor and they form a hormone receptor complex. And once the hormone receptor complex formed, it gets translocated into the nucleus to bind with the specific sequence of DNA called as hormone response elements. That is the sequence of DNA to which the hormone receptor, translocated hormone receptor complex will come and bind. Some hormones can directly enter into the nucleus and bind to the nuclear receptor and hormone response element. This hormone response element will influence gene expression for the transcription of mRNA, and this mRNA will get translated into specific protein to bring about the desired hormone effects. This is how the group hormones will basically act. So here is the picture where the group 1 steroid hormones mechanism of action is explained. So this is a cell of an endocrine gland where the hormones, steroid hormones, are secreted and they enter into the bloodstream. So through the bloodstream, they reach the target cell. In the target cells, since they are lipophilic hormones, they can easily traverse the cell membrane by passive diffusion and again into the nucleus also. And in the nucleus, they bind to the receptor, and after binding to the receptor, they form a complex of hormone receptor complex here, which will again come and bind to the DNA specific sequence called as hormone response element. So after it binds to hormone response element, it activates or represses transcription depending upon what is the action of the hormone. and by way of activating transcription, it controls translation and bring about synthesis of in specific proteins in which the cell activity can be altered. In here it is explained. Here you can see steroid hormone easily traversing the membrane by passive diffusion, binding to the receptor protein, and again getting translated into the nucleus. And this hormone receptor complex will come and bind to the hormone responsible element of the DNA and bring about transcription of mRNA, and this mRNA will bring about translation of protein or synthesis of protein. Same thing is explained here. And lastly, we will get about the metabolic responses which we desire. And here you can see this hormone. When hormone is not bind with the receptor, it is actually by default bound with the heat shock protein 19, which will actually keep the hormone receptor in an inactive state. So once the hormone reaches the nucleus, this will interact with the inactive receptor and will cause dissociation of heat shock protein and activation of receptor, resulting in formation of hormone receptor complex, and it results in producing desired metabolic effect. Group 2 hormone mechanism of action. So these are the hormones which are water soluble and they basically work through second messenger. So this type of hormones do not enter the cell. So hence the receptor and the cell membrane of the target cell will relay the message from the hormone into the cell or within the cytoplasm by way of a compound called as second messenger. So here you can see extracellular fluid or outside the cell, hormone is present which will come and bind to the cell membrane located receptor, and they transduce the signal by way of second messenger and they alter the activity of cell. So the first messenger is nothing but the ligand, that is it carries the message to be transported to the DNA or whatever. So it will come and bind to the receptor and they bring about alteration of the G protein coupled receptor, and this will produce an effector or which is nothing but an enzyme which can be either activated or deactivated. This enzyme, depending upon their activation or deactivation, will convert an inactive second messenger to an active second messenger. And this active second messenger, for example, here it is given as cyclic AMP, will activate the respective kinases and bring about a cascade of cellular responses, which are nothing but so many metabolic and structural changes. So second messengers which are linked to the G protein. G protein linked receptors are transmembrane proteins that loop 7 times through the plasma membrane. So these receptors which are linked to G protein are 7 pass transmembrane proteins. G protein consists of basically alpha, beta and gamma subunits. So the receptor activates G protein will bind to alpha subunit. So when inactive, is G protein is bound to GDP. So when there is an activated receptor, G protein will bind GDP. And when there is an inactivated receptor, G protein is bound to GDP. So this alpha subunit will bind to both GDP and GDP when the receptor is active or inactive respectively. Then the G proteins, once it binds to GDP, will interact with adenylyl cyclase, an enzyme which is the effector, which makes activation of cyclic AMP, inactive cyclic AMP. And here G protein has got two different entities. One is the GS and the other is GA. GS, which means will stimulate adenylyl cyclase and bring about increased production of cyclic AMP. GI will inhibit adenylyl cyclase and there will be decreased production of cyclic AMP. So when the hormone will bind to the stimulatory receptor, the G protein will release GDP and will bind to GDP, and this enables it to activate the adenylyl cyclase. Here you can see the 7-pass transmembrane receptor located on the plasma membrane, and the hormone, and this is the G protein which is made up of alpha, beta and gamma subunit, and alpha subunit is bound to GDP. That means it's an inactive G protein. So the hormone will come and bind to the 7-pass transmembrane protein, and this will interact with the inactive G protein and bring about activation of G protein by exchanging GDP for GDP. And after that, there is dissociation of alpha GTP complex from the beta gamma subunit. So this alpha GTP complex will dissociate from the gamma beta gamma complex and will go on bind with the effector, or it can activate or stimulate, inhibit the effector, which is nothing but the adenylate cyclase enzyme. This adenylate cyclase enzyme will favor conversion of ATP to the second messenger cyclic AMP. This cyclic AMP will convert later cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase to active cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase. This active cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase will be in the phosphorylation of enzyme and will result in so many metabolic responses. So next we'll move on to what is a cyclic AMP. Cyclic AMP is the most common second messenger, and the hormones will bind the receptors and the membrane bound adenyl cyclase is activated by the G protein. So when the hormones will bind the receptors, the membrane bound adenyl cyclase will be activated by the G protein. Adenyl cyclase will catalyze the conversion of ATP to cyclic AMP as I described in the previous slide. And this cyclic AMP will activate protein kinases, which will in turn catalyze the phosphorylation of a specific protein, thereby triggering a chain of reactions leading to the particular metabolic effect of the hormones. Protein kinases are very specific in action, and one more property of cyclic AMP is that it is rapidly inactivated and converted to AMP. So synthesis and degradation of cyclic AMP is given in this picture. So this is a cell membrane where we have got embedded adenyl cyclase, is getting activated by way of hormone binding to the specific receptor. So when this is activated, this will favor conversion of ATP to cyclic AMP, which will bring about the conversion of inactive protein kinase to active protein kinase, and that will bring about the phosphorylation of the desired protein and its further physiological effects. Whereas the cyclic AMP will be converted into deactivated into 5' AMP by way of enzyme phosphodiesterase immediately after its action is activated. So again here, same picture. Once the endocrine gland secretes the hormones, it will enter the bloodstream, and this will come and bind to the cell membrane receptor, and this hormone receptor complex will activate G protein that will again activate adenyl cyclase, which will bring about conversion of ATP to cyclic AMP. And the cyclic AMP will activate protein kinase, and this phosphorylates specific cellular proteins and cell activities. So hormones which act through cyclic AMP includes ACTH, TSH, LH, FSH, PTH or parathormone, antidiuretic hormone, and human chorio-gonadotropin. And then glucagon, calcitonin, CRH, MSH, and alpha 2 and beta adrenergic corticolamines and somatostatin. Next, we'll move on to what are protein kinases. Protein kinases are certain enzymes which will phosphorylate proteins. That is, they can add phosphate group to the specific protein. So there will be a change in charge at that site, which makes major changes in the conformation of the enzyme and affect its activity. So this is brought about by activated cyclic AMP. So once this action is completed, cyclic AMP will be inactivated by phosphodiesterase, which quickly act to downregulate its activity. Again, same explained. So cyclic AMP, until this we know, so this cyclic AMP bring about activation of different type of protein kinase. Protein kinase 1, protein kinase 2, and protein kinase 3. Protein kinase 1 will basically affect the metabolism. Protein kinase 2 will affect membrane permeability. Protein kinase 3 will affect gene activity. The second messenger is nothing but cyclic GMP, which is derived from GTP upon the action of guanyl cyclase enzyme. So several compounds like nitric oxide and atrial natriuretic peptide will activate the guanyl cyclase, which in turn increases cyclic GMP. And this cyclic GMP, similar to cyclic AMP, will activate protein kinases and phosphorylate certain enzymes, which will bring about smooth muscle relaxation and vasodilatation. And cyclic GMP was also found to be involved in rhodopsin visual cycle. Similar to cyclic AMP, cyclic GMP also, once this their effect is produced, it will be quickly inactivated to control its, have a check on its activity by phosphodiesterase enzyme to 5' GMP. The synthesis, First is the synthesis. GTP is converted to cyclic GMP way of enzyme water and cyclase. And similarly, degradation cyclic GMP will be degraded by phosphodiesterase into 5' GMP. Third, second messenger is inositol, triphosphate, and diacylglycerol. These are the phospholipid products which can act as second messenger. Phosphatidyl inositol 4,5-bisphosphate present in the lipid biomembrane will be split into inositol triphosphate and diacylglycerol. Inositol triphosphate will cause release of calcium from the endoplasmic reticulum, whereas diacylglycerol will move on to activate protein kinase C along with the calcium calmodulin complex. So protein kinase C in turn will phosphorylate proteins that will generate various cellular effects. So here you can see the receptor, membrane-bound receptor, the messenger, first messenger, which is the hormone, will come and bind and will bring about activation of G protein by way of exchanging GTP for GTP. So this alpha GTP complex will dissociate from beta gamma complex and will go on bind with the effector which is present in the membrane, which is nothing but phospholipase C. This phospholipase C will favor conversion of conversion of phosphatidyl inositol inositol triphosphate and diacylglycerol. This inositol triphosphate, as explained, will cause calcium release from the endoplasmic reticulum. So this is the endoplasmic reticulum, and this will go and favor opening of calcium channel which is present, and they will favor exit of calcium from the endoplasmic reticulum into the cytosol. Whereas this diacylglycerol will go and activate protein kinase C, which will convert or dephosphorylate ATP and phosphorylate the desired protein, and resulting in production of protein phosphatase and produce the desired response in the cell. Whereas the IP3 favored release of calcium will act with calmodulin and activate protein kinase, which will again phosphorylate certain proteins and bring about certain responses in cell, which will include either a contracted response or transport or metabolism. And same thing explained here. Hormone will come and bind with the receptor and cause activation of G protein, which will cause activation of phospholipase C, which all happens in the cell membrane. Then what happens in the cytosol is conversion of phosphatidyl inositol to IPAG and IP3. IP3 will favor release of stored calcium from endoplasmic reticulum and mitochondria, which will complexes this calcium release will complex with calmodulin to form calcium calmodulin complex, and which will cause phosphorylation of the enzyme protein that will bring about the metabolic responses. And here on the other side, diacylglycerol will directly activate protein kinase C, which will again phosphorylate protein and bring about the desired cell responses. Formation of IP3 and DAG again is explained here, which is brought about by phospholipase C. Fourth category of second messenger is calcium ions. So the non-stimulated cytoplasmic calcium concentration is ideally very, very low. So some stimulation events will cause transient inhibition of intracellular calcium. This calcium can bind certain proteins and regulate cellular function. So the calcium protein binding, which we get by way of all these increase in calcium in the cytosolic region, is brought about by calcium calmodulin complex. So what are the calcium-based regulation we know? Calcium entry can occur in response to a G-protein stimulated event, and calcium will bind with calmodulin to form calcium calmodulin complex, which will activate protein kinase and regulate certain cellular events. So that is what the second by way of IP3, you know, that was what explained separately as calcium based regulation. So here same thing, once the G protein is activated after hormone receptor complex formation, calcium is made to enter into the plasma membrane from the extracellular fluid. There it is from the calcium is released from the endoplasmic reticulum and mitochondria, whereas here from the extracellular fluid, calcium enters and will bind with the calmodulin, and it will activate kinase, which will again phosphorylate the protein and bring about the desired cellular effects. Same thing is explained here. So hormones which act through inositol or calcium includes alpha 1 adrenergic catecholamines, acetylcholine, angiotensin 2, cholecystokinin, gastrin, gonadotropin releasing hormone, oxytocin, platelet derived growth factor, substance P, thyrotrophin releasing hormone. So what is the another second messenger which is most commonly missed is protein kinase. So binding of some hormones like insulin to the respective membrane receptor will activate a specific protein kinase called as tyrosine kinase. This tyrosine kinase, what it does is it will phosphorylate the tyrosine residue of specific protein and will further bring about the metabolic changes. So here you can see this is the insulin receptor which is made up of heterotetradimers. This is a dimer. And it is again made up of two different subunits. So it is hetero and it is a hetero. This dimer is again associated to form the tetradimer. So it is called as heterotetradimer, to which we have tyrosine residues attached the intracellular side. So what happens? Hormones like insulin will come and bind to this heterotetradimer receptor. That is the, it is nothing but a protein kinase enzyme, and will bring about phosphorylation of the tyrosine residues present intracellularly. So this will bring about phosphorylation of cytosolic protein kinases and the desired metabolic responses. So hormones which act through protein kinase include insulin, growth hormone, prolactin, insulin-like growth factors 1 and 2, chorionic somatomammotropin, epidermal growth factor, erythropoietin, fibroblast growth factor, leptin, nerve growth factor, platelet-derived growth factor, and adiponectin. So again, here it is explained, the alpha subunit will bind with insulin, which is the first messenger of the signal, and the beta subunit is where the tyrosine residues will get phosphorylated by way of protein kinase activation, and this will bring about the conversion of insulin response substrate phosphorylation, and this will bring about cellular responses. Here is the insulin receptor. This dimers are linked by disulfide bridges, and here is the proteasensitive region, tyrosine kinase domains, where upon insulin binding, tyrosine residues are phosphorylated, which will again favor phosphorylation of insulin receptor substrates. And this in turn will cause conversion of phosphatidylinositol triphosphate cleavage into IP3 and DNs. So here insulin activated signal transduction pathway is explained. So once insulin comes and binds, it will bring about two desired signals. One is the metabolic signal, second is the growth signal. So in metabolic signal is by certain second messengers, which are nothing but insulin receptor substrates 1, 2, 3, 4, which will phosphorylate or activate phosphatidylinositol 3 kinase and bring about glucose uptake into the cell and by way of blood flow transportation. And the second effect is by lipid metabolism. The third effect is on glycogen synthesis. And the fourth effect is on protein synthesis. Whereas the growth signal will act through SHC complex and will activate RAS MAP kinase pathway and bring about cell proliferation and protein synthesis for cell growth. So with this, mechanism of hormone action has been finished. And thank you.